Hi, everyone. There we go. It's fantastic to see you all here. This is my second ng-conf, and I'm super thrilled to be back here. Let's give it up for the organizers as well. You guys are amazing. Those prizes are fantastic. So I'm here to talk to you today about why real-time matters and building real-time applications with Firebase and Angular. So throw your hand up for me if you've heard of Firebase. There we go. Those are some hands. And if you've used Firebase, keep them up. Okay. Cool. Good to see you. So my name is James Tamplin. I'm the co-founder of Firebase. And today we're going to be covering why real-time matters, Firebase's role in real-time, and then a little bit about AngularFire, which is how Firebase plays really nicely with Angular. So first, let's all get on the same page about real-time data. So real-time data is data that is delivered immediately after collection. So in the context of the web, this is typically when a server pushes data down to a client, modifies a view, and it's updated without the user having to do anything. That data can come from other clients, it can come from other servers, APIs, sensors, you name it. But this notion of the server pushing data to a client wasn't around when the web actually started. Tim Berners-Lee built the web to be request response, so the server couldn't actually initiate. And it was kludged in around 1996 with JavaScript applets, and then eventually made its way into HTTP and JavaScript around 2000, and is now the standard that we know, and depending on the day and which way the wind's blowing, that we love, which is WebSockets. But regardless of the technology progression, it's clear that the user experience has progressed. And now modern applications are real-time. If I post on your Facebook wall, you see it immediately. If I pull out my phone and look at Uber, I see the car's location up to the second. When I'm in Google Docs and I type a character, everyone sees that instantly. So social tools have become more social. Productivity tools have become more productive. And most importantly, users have come to expect real-time experiences. Not just from these guys, but from everyone. So real-time matters because it drives up engagement, adds context, and fosters collaboration. So it helps engagement because users like data that's delivered to them without them having to do anything. It increases context because it doesn't matter if you get a restaurant recommendation hours or even minutes after you've gone by it. And it fosters collaboration. I can't even count how many hours have been saved through tools like Asana and Trello for project management, Cloud9 IDE, or Nitrous for coding, and Google Docs in the productivity suite. So we talked a little bit about why real-time matters. Now, there are options for making your Angular app real-time. One of the most popular methods is the open-source library Socket.io. It's a message-passing library. There's closed-source ones, hosted ones like PubNub and Pusher that do a similar thing. But I'm going to talk to you today about Firebase, and Firebase takes a little bit of a different approach. So Firebase is a real-time backend for your Angular app. And we built a cool piece of technology that lets you build an application without needing to write any server code or spin up any servers. You focus on the user experience. We take care of the rest. Now, at the core of Firebase, there's a hosted NoSQL JSON database. And it's accessible through a variety of SDKs. We have iOS, Android, JavaScript, and REST. And when you write data to Firebase, it saves it up to our servers and propagates it, synchronizes it to every device in milliseconds. Now, this means that every Firebase app is real-time by default. In addition to our real-time database, we've got a great user management system. It stops you from having to fight with OAuth, and you can even integrate your own custom OAuth provider. And we have a hosting service, which lets you deploy your application assets up to our cloud. We have a CDN that we put them on, and we even provision your own SSL cert. We actually launched it a year ago here at ng-conf 2014. And now we've got almost 10,000 sites using it, including the new Angular IO, which you saw this morning. Whoops. So that's a little bit about Firebase. Now let's talk about how Firebase integrates with Angular. We do it through a library called AngularFire. So AngularFire is a set of services that help you bind data between Firebase and Angular. Angular is known for its two-way data binding, so you bind your view to your JavaScript models. AngularFire takes it one step further. We actually bind your JavaScript models to the Firebase database. And since the Firebase database synchronizes to all clients in real time, this means that whenever one of your end users changes their view, it syncs up to Firebase, and that view change is reflected to every other person actually using that Firebase app. This is pretty cool. We call it three-way data binding. So you can find AngularFire online on GitHub. It's an open source repo. You can find it on our website, and it's also in the footer of the new Angular.io site. So let's kind of get down into some of the nuts and bolts. So AngularFire has three services it exposes: Firebase Array, Firebase Object, and Firebase Auth. Now, Firebase Array synchronizes collections, so you have a list of tweets, maybe a to-do list. Firebase Object, in an unforeseen plot twist, synchronizes objects. So, user profile data or, every single one of your fully operational fleet of mobile barbers, if you're in the mobile barber business. And we also have Firebase Auth. And so Firebase Auth provides a wrapper around that core Firebase authentication service, but it exposes in a way that you guys are going to be familiar with inside Angular. So how does this actually work? Well, what we first do is we add the Firebase module to your app. This then allows you to inject any one of those three services into any Angular factory provider or service. So in this case, we're using Firebase Array. And then what we actually do is we drop down to the Firebase API. So what I'm doing here when I say varf equals new Firebase is I'm creating a reference. And now you can think of a reference like a pointer to a piece of data inside Firebase. One of the core concepts in Firebase is every single piece of data has its own URL. And you could do some really, really cool stuff with that URL, like punch it into a browser and see a view of your data. But now we have this reference. We can operate on it. We can write to Firebase, and we can listen for changes. So what I do here is I create an instance of Firebase Array. I pass it that ref. And then on $scope, I have an items array. And it acts like a normal JavaScript array. So I can do things like ng-repeat over it or use any of the Angular filters. So for those of you who kind of typically wire up backends to Angular applications, you're probably thinking to yourself, like, OK, this is all cool, but like, where do you actually like hook up the backend? And the answer is those two lines of code are it. This is it. This is hooking up Angular to the backend. This looks for changes, notifies Angular when there's changes, triggers dirty checking, updates the view, like the whole nine yards. And this is why AngularFire is so powerful to connect Angular and Firebase, because of its simplicity. So we touched on Firebase Array and Firebase Object. We've got some cool stuff in the authentication realm as well. So Firebase Auth allows you to track anonymous users with anonymous auth. You can do easily email and password auth, full OAuth with a bunch of social providers, Twitter, Facebook, GitHub, Google. And you can even integrate with your own custom solution if you already have like a users table that you've built. One of the coolest things is route-based security. So one of the pains with client-side authentication is figuring out if a user can actually is allowed to do something before they do it. And typically, controllers are sort of like littered with if-else statements to like figure out if this is the case. And with AngularFire, what we've done is we've actually merged routing and auth security into this single resolve method. And this is really cool because you don't have to worry if a user is authenticated. We'll route to the appropriate place if they're not. So for those of you with eagle eyes in the audience, you're going to notice that there's been a few changes to the API that I've showed here on stage today. And that's because we're really, really excited to announce, after 2 years of work and over 50 contributors, that live today is AngularFire 1.0. This has been an awesome effort, both from our core team and from folks across the community. So it's out of beta. Point releases are now going to be backwards compatible. The API is dramatically simplified. And like with any Firebase product, we've spent a lot of time on documentation, live code examples, really kind of delivering the user experience that we've been known for. So now I've talked a little bit about AngularFire. Let's jump over to another piece of the Angular ecosystem where real time is super important, and that's mobile. So Ionic is, I'm sure all of you guys have heard of it. It's a rising star in the Angular community. But real-time is super important on mobile. It's important for a couple of major reasons, the first of which is pull-to-refresh needs to die. It's a terrible user experience. It's going to seem super archaic. It probably already does to many of you. The second thing that real-time really helps with on mobile is unreliable internet connections. So Firebase, with our sync approach, the actual local client has a version of the data. So if you're going through a tunnel or your internet connection is spotty, the application still stays responsive. So I'm going to show you a quick demo here. And this demo is inspired by my love for my Rolodex, my physical Rolodex. But there was a problem with this, and that's that it couldn't hold all of my friends. So I've gone ahead and fixed that. I built a mobile app that has infinite scroll to do so with Firebase. So we'll show you a quick example here. So I'm here in Ionic Lab. I've got my iOS on the left, my Android on the right. So new items, because it's all built with Firebase, new items will pop in the top, edits will change, and as I scroll down, you can see new items load in the bottom without me having to do anything. And as I switch to the code for this, I'm going to show you just how easy it is to do. So I'm in a controller here, and as we talked about earlier, we're creating a Firebase ref. Now here I'm creating another ref, and I'm actually using this Firebase util library that we're also announcing today. It's got some really cool utility methods, like implementing pagination and infinite scroll. So we pass that scroll ref, and we create using Firebase array. We add an array to scope.items. We first load the first three items, and then whenever we hit the bottom, we start loading more. This is all you need to do to build real-time infinite scroll with Firebase, Ionic, and Angular. So we've talked about Angular 1, we've talked about Ionic. Let's talk a little bit about Angular 2. So one of the things we're super excited about in Angular 2, and one that's extremely relevant to real-time, is change detection. Concretely, Angular 2 means that there's no more dollar scope and no more dollar watch. So with Angular 2's change detection, instead of like triggering a digest loop where the entire scope tree is traversed, you can actually specify which items to update and which items to skip. So in this example here, I'm actually just going to update the items where the old value is not equal to the new value. This is going to be an incredible performance increase, and especially for real-time integrations like AngularFire. So we've talked a little bit about Angular 1, we've talked about Ionic, and we've touched briefly on Angular 2. And it's pretty clear that real-time matters more than ever. So users are coming to expect these great real-time experiences and coming to expect them from more than just top-tier tech companies. If you're still using CRUD services over the coming weeks, months, years, you should evaluate your architecture and kind of see like what services, what real-time services can offer you in the future. So in the gave that away a little bit. In the next kind of few remaining minutes, I want to kind of stop briefly and take some time to thank you. Thank you, the Angular community. You guys are awesome. So Firebase is, we've been around for a little over 3 years now. And we've done integrations with many pieces of technology. But we haven't interacted with a community that is as engaged and like truly excited as the Angular community. I can't even count the number of conversations that we've had through Google Groups, through Twitter, the number of like interactions we have on GitHub. There are countless Firebase talks that have been given in Angular groups around the world. It's really been humbling to interact with you guys and see how cool you all are. But I have one person who's kind of my favorite, and I met him last year at ng-conf, and it's, of course, the unicorn. I don't know if he's here this year, but seriously, thank you very much. We wouldn't be here today if it weren't for this community. And so for those of you who don't kind of haven't heard the news or haven't kept up where we actually are today, we've joined Google. So Google acquired Firebase in October of last year. And so our team of 23 Moved over to Google SF and has grown significantly since then. We now have 160,000 developers using Firebase. And we're excited to be a part of Google and kind of interact with Google and take advantage of the resources that Google has. I'm also excited and proud to now call the Angular core team colleagues. One of the things I want to highlight before we leave is this transition to Google definitely means that our interactions with the community aren't going to change. We're still going to be as visible and engaged as we were before, and nothing there changes. And so with that kind of in mind, I want to lead into two more things instead of just one more thing. They're two small feature announcements that we want to announce today. The first of which available today is private backups. So you're now starting today able to export your entire Firebase database out to your S3 bucket or your Google Cloud Storage bucket. Now we already back up your data, but this allows you to export it for things like analytics, testing, and it's available starting today for our Bonfire and Up customers. The second question that we get asked quite a bit is, how does Firebase play nicely with search engines and SEO? And today we're excited to announce that we've updated our server, our client, worked with the Google search team to provide SEO support in Firebase. So if you're using our latest SDK, search engine crawlers, now instead of seeing just this in your view template, we'll actually see the content, be able to index it. It's something that a lot of people have been asking for and a lot of people are very excited about, so we're glad we can ship that. And in true Firebase fashion, we're not just going to stop here. We're excited to integrate with pre-rendering services and hook those up to our hosting product, so watch out for those later on in the year. So that concludes my talk on why real-time matters and building real-time applications with Angular and Firebase. We're going to be around for the entire conference. We're just out here in the yellow shirts. David East, Jacob Wanger, and Cato Wolf from our team are all here. They all have spent an enormous amount of time with Angular, so please come and say hi and have a great rest of the conference. Thank you.